In the last learning module, we spent a lot of time talking about what double integrals are, and a certain amount of time talking about what they're good for. What we didn't talk about is how you actually go about computing double integrals. That's the purpose of this learning module. And the key theme is the sixth pillar of calculus, one variable at a time. We're going to do an integral over a two-dimensional region by integrating first over one variable and then over the second variable. So, for example, let's suppose that we're asked to compute the integral of x minus y squared dA over a rectangle. And that rectangle is going to be where x goes from 0 to 1 and y goes from 0 to 2. So here's a picture of a rectangle. And you remember that what a double integral means is that we take this rectangle and we chop it up into a bunch of little boxes. And for each box, we're going to take the value, we're going to pick a point, xij star, yij star, the sample point, somewhere in that box. And then we're going to take the value of the function at that point and multiply it by the area of the box. And then we have to add up the contributions for all of the boxes, and that'll give us a pretty good approximation to the integral. And then we want to take a limit as we chop things up into smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller boxes. Now, there's nobody who tell us how we're supposed to add up the contributions of the boxes. Maybe we should take this guy and then add 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 this guy in some crazy order. Now, doing things in a crazy order is not going to be very useful. In order to get good results, we're going to have to come up with a way to organize all of our boxes. And the basic idea is we're going to add up all of the boxes in a column. And then we're going to add up all of the boxes in the next column. And then we're going to add up all the boxes in the next column and all the boxes in the next column. So we're going to figure things out one column at a time. We're going to figure out how much stuff there is in each column. And then we're going to put the columns all together and get how much stuff there is in all. So let's start that. So one thing that helps is for picking our sample point, let's use a rule like the midpoint rule that means that xij star only depends on what column you're in and yij star only depends on what row you're in. So the picture of that is we're going to pick all of these points to have the same x value. And then all of these points are going to have the same y value. So the x value only depends on which column you're in. The y value only depends on which row you're in. Now, once you do that, so the boxes in the same column have the same value of x star. The boxes in the same row have the same value of y star. Once you do that, you want to figure out how much there is in a column. And to figure out how much there is in the column, you have to add up all the boxes that are in the column. Now, all the boxes all have the same value of x, and they've got the same delta x, so we can pull the delta x out of the sum. And so we wind up with this kind of sum, where delta y is the largest value of y minus the smallest value divided by n. And now we're going to take a limit as we chop this up finer and finer and finer and finer. Well, this sum approaches this integral. That's the definition of an integral. An integral is a limit of a sum. So instead of summing over different values of y, we integrate over all values of y between 0 and 1. And let's give this guy a name. We'll call it g of, you know, this expression. Different values of x will give you different values of this integral. So the result is going to be a function of x, and then we multiply it by delta x. So the way to find out how much is in a column is to integrate vertically f of x, y, dy. Well, then once we know what each column contributes, we can add up all the columns, and you get the sum of g of xi star delta x. And then when you chop the columns, chop things horizontally, finer and finer and finer and finer, this sum becomes an integral. And we get this integral. So let's do that. So we want the double integral over our region of f of x, y, dA. And in this case, our region has y going from 0 to 1 and x going from 0 to 2. So we integrate as y goes from 0 to 1. And we discover that, well, let's see, when we do this integral, x is a constant because it's a single column. All the points in that column have the same value of x. So x is just a constant. We integrate a constant minus y squared dy. Well, that's pretty easy. That just gives me the constant minus y cubed over 3 times negative 1 because we're talking about minus y. We plug it in at y equals 0 and at y equals 1. Plug it in at y equals 1 and we get x minus 1 cubed over 3 with a minus sign. Plug it in at y equals 0 and we get x cubed over 3. So this integral gives you x cubed minus x minus 1 cubed over 3. And then when we want to integrate that over x, well, that's easy. We know how to integrate x cubed over 3 dx. That just gives us x to the 4th over 12. We know how to integrate x minus 1 cubed over 3. That gives us x minus 1 to the 4th over 12. And we plug in the values at 2 and at 0. And pop, we get our answer. So this double integral of x minus y squared over this rectangle was 4/3 because we did it one variable at a time. We integrated over y to get the contribution of the column, and then we integrated over x to put all the columns together. So to recap, you chop things up into boxes, and the contribution of each box is the function you're trying to integrate times delta x times delta y. If you put the columns together, put all the boxes in a column together, you and imagine chopping things vertically finer and finer and finer and finer, then in place of a sum over f of x, y, you get an integral. You integrate over y to get the entire column, and there's still a factor of dx in there. The thing that you integrate, we give it a name, we call it g of x. And then the entire integral is the integral of g of x dx, which we could also write as the integral from 0 to 2. See, x goes from 0 to 2 of the integral as y goes from 0 to 1 of f of x, y, dy times dx. This is what we call an iterated integral because we integrate first over one variable and then over the other variable. Okay. So this, we did it for a particular example, but the result is really general. And here's what Fubini's theorem says. Fubini's theorem says, if we've got any rectangular region, so we got a rectangle where x goes from A to B and y goes from C to D, and we've got a continuous function on that region that we want to integrate, then if you want to get the double integral of that function over the region, you do it one variable at a time. You first integrate over y, where y goes from C to D, because those are the ranges of y. And then what you get out is this function g of x. And then you integrate that from A to B dx. Or you could first integrate horizontally. You can integrate f of x, y dx from the lowest value of x to the biggest value of x. That's a function. Let's call it h of y. And then you integrate that function dy from C to D. Either way, you get the answer.